And welcome to this evening's performance of A Charlie Brown Christmas, brought to you by our first night cast. We hope you enjoy the show.
Oh, It was finally Christmas time, the best time of the year. The houses were strung with tiny colored lights, their windows shining with the warm yellow glow only Christmas could bring.
The scents of pine needles and hot cocoa mingled together, drifting through the air, and the sweet sounds of Christmas could be heard in the distance.
Fluffy white snowflakes tumbled from the sky onto a group of joyful children as they sang and laughed, skating on the frozen pond in town.
Everyone was happy and full of holiday cheer, that is, everyone except for Charlie Brown.
So, Charlie Brown went to check his mailbox. Surely, somebody must have sent him a Christmas card.
Hello in there. Rats. Nobody sent me a Christmas card. I know nobody likes me, but why do we have to have a holiday season to emphasize it? Thanks for the Christmas card you sent me, Violet.
I didn't send you a Christmas card, Charlie Brown.
Don't you know a sarcasm when you hear it?
I do.
Pigpen, you're the only person I know who can raise a cloud of dust in a snowstorm.
Got that right.
Good grief.
Still feeling bad, Charlie Brown decided he might want to do something to feel a little more Christmassy. As luck would have it, his neighbor Lucy Van Pelt had a psychiatric service as one of her many business ventures.
Try to catch a snowflake on your tongue. It's fun.
Need sugar. It's too early. I never eat December snowflakes. I always wait till January. They taste much better.
They sure look ripe to me.
Yeah, but they taste better than January snowflakes.
You think you're so smart with that stupid blanket, don't you, Linus? What are you gonna do with it when you grow up?
Maybe I'll turn it into a sports coat.
Hey, Lucy, I think you have a customer.
Oh, duty calls. See you later, everyone.
While the rest of the group went to skate at the frozen pond, Lucy met Charlie Brown at her booth. He was one of her best customers.
Well, 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 Charlie Brown. What brings you in on this fine Christmassy day?
I'm in sad shape.
Hold up there, Charlie Brown. I must ask that you pay in advance for my kind advice. 5 cents, please.
As you can see, Lucy was an entrepreneur.
Boy, oh boy, I love the beautiful sound of cold hard cash. That beautiful sound of nickels. Nickels, nickels, nickels. What a beautiful sound of cold hard cash. All right now, Charlie Brown. What seems to be your trouble?
I feel depressed. I know I should be happy, but I'm not.
Well, as they say on TV, the mere fact that you realize you need help indicates that you are not too far gone. I think we better pinpoint your fears. If we can find out what you're afraid of, we can label it. Are you afraid of responsibility? If you are, then you have hyphengeophobia. Are you afraid of cats? If you are, then you have aliophasia. Are you afraid of staircases? If you are, then you have climacophobia, or maybe you have thalassophobia, which is the fear of the ocean, or maybe you have Jeffreyophobia, which is the fear of crossing bridges, or maybe you have pantophobia. Do you think you have pantophobia?
What's pantophobia?
The fear of everything.
That's when it hit him.
That's it!
Kind of.
Actually, Lucy, my trouble is Christmas. Instead of feeling excited and happy like everyone else, I feel sort of let down.
Sounds like you need involvement. You need to be involved in some real Christmas project. How would you like to be the director of our Christmas play?
Me? You want me to be the director of the Christmas play?
Sure, Charlie Brown. We need a director. You need involvement. We've got a shepherd, musicians, animals, everyone we need. We've even got a Christmas queen.
Well, I don't know anything about directing a Christmas play.
Don't worry. I'll be there to help you. Meet me at the auditorium on Monday. Incidentally, I know how you feel about all this Christmas business. Getting depressed and all that, it happens to me every year. I never get what I really want. I always get a lot of stupid toys or a bicycle or clothes or something like that.
What is it you want?
Real estate.
What is it, Snoopy? You want me to come with you? Sure.
Sounds interesting. I'll come too.
Despite Snoopy's optimism, Charlie Brown was soon to be disappointed by what his dog had to show him.
What is all this? Find the true meaning of Christmas. Win money, money, money. Spectacular, super colossal, neighborhood Christmas lights and display contest. My own dog gone commercial.
Yes, even his very own dog had gone commercial. The thought of the contest made Charlie Brown sick to his stomach. Was this all anyone cared about? Charlie Brown couldn't stand it.
I can't stand it.
Well, now that I really know being our director will make you feel better, let's go.
Good this year, so I have a long list of presents that I would like.
Oh, brother.
Please Please note the size and color of each item and send as many as possible. And if it seems too complicated, make it easy on yourself. Just send money. How about tens and twenties?
Tens and twenties? Oh, even my baby sister. I can't write your letter.
All I want is my fair share. Maybe I should follow Lucy's example and go on something more business related. I have a great idea.
And so, Sally took it upon herself to start selling Christmas wreaths. She went door to door and found little luck.
Would you like to buy a Christmas wreath?
No!
Okay, then. Would you like to buy a Christmas wreath?
There's still over a week left until Christmas. By the time that it rolls around, all the needles will have fallen off.
Just make sure to water it.
No, then.
Rats. Would you like to buy a Christmas wreath?
Don't you know what you're doing?
Huh?
Don't you know you're adding to the over-commercialization of Christmas?
Not until I sell one.
I'm not interested.
Rats again.
Sally was about to ready to close up shop when she could sense a familiar boy and his blanket were nearby.
Hey, Sally.
Oh, hello, my sweet Babu. Are you here to help me sell Christmas wreaths?
Actually, I was wondering if you knew where Charlie Brown was.
Well, I asked him to help me with my letter to Santa Claus, but he left me in another one of his states of depression. Not sure where he's now, though.
Huh. Guess I'll look for him later. Want some company selling Christmas wreaths?
Would I ever? I haven't sold a single one.
Maybe you need to change tactics.
Change tactics, huh? I've got it. Follow my lead on to the next door.
Hi, Sally. Hi, Linus.
Hi, Shermie. Would your mother like to buy a Christmas wreath? Tell her they are made from the forests of Lebanon. You can read about them in the second chapter in the second book of Chronicles. And if you buy two, we'll throw in an autographed photo of King Solomon himself.
Ooh, let me tell my mom.
You can't tell them those wreaths were made from the forests of Lebanon.
Why not?
My mom says we'll take two.
Wonderful. It's been a pleasure doing business with you, Shermie.
Bye. Thanks again. I'll see you guys at school.
Bye. See you, Linus. It's as easy as that.
Sally, that's not right.
Oh, come on, Linus. It was just exaggerating.
It's lying.
Do you guys have a minute to help us out?
Your little bird friend can come too.
Would you like to help us sell Christmas wreaths?
Follow us to the next door. Here, I'll let you hold our Christmas wreaths. Just act natural.
Hi, Sally. What an adorable dog you have. And he's even got a friend.
Yeah, they're just adorable. And speaking of adorable, would you like to purchase one of our adorable Christmas wreaths?
Of course. Let me get my mother's purse.
Yay!
Ooh! Okay.
Christmas time is here, time for toys and good, Simon.
Naturally.
Very good, Theodore. Alvin, you're a little flat. So watch it next time. Alvin!
Okay.
What a plane that loops the loop. We are one and hula hoop. We can hardly stand away. Please, Christmas, don't be late. We can hardly stand away. Please, Christmas, don't be late.
Very good, Chipmunks.
Let's sing it again.
Yeah, let's sing it again.
No, that's enough. Let's not overdo it.
What do you mean overdo it?
Yeah, let's sing it again. Come on.
Yeah,
let's sing it again.
Let's
sing it again. Let's sing it again.
And now we enter the strange world of Peppermint Patty.
Guess what, Chuck? Disaster time. Our teacher wants us to read a whole book before Christmas break starts. Got any suggestions?
On what book to read?
No, on how to get out of it.
I don't think I have any solutions for you, Peppermint Patty.
Rats. Well, thanks anyway, Chuck. I'll see you at school.
See you later.
It took Peppermint Patty a few days, but she came up with her own solution to her reading predicament.
I'm not gonna have to read a book before Christmas break after all, Marcy. See? A Tale of Two Cities was just on TV. I watched the movie, so I won't have to read the book. The only parts I didn't understand were about the shampoo, the soap, and the coffee.
Those were the commercials, sir.
Oh. You know, maybe I'll have to read a book after all.
Well, I always keep a couple of extra books in my backpack. Take a look and see if there's something you might be interested in.
Sure.
How about this one? How the Grinch Stole Christmas? Maybe you should pick something a little more challenging for the report.
You're right, I guess. Okay, how about this one?
A Christmas Carol. That would be a good one.
I don't know, Marcy. I'm scared.
Because of the ghosts?
No. I had a grandfather who didn't think much of reading. He always said, if you read too many books, your head would fall off.
Well, start the first chapter, sir, and I'll make sure to hold into your head.
With Marcy's help, Peppermint Patty was able to get through a whole two chapters that day. On the flip side, she forgot to read for the next week and a half. Peppermint Patty had only 5 more days until the book report was due. She could be seen out in her backyard procrastinating.
Why aren't you reading your book, sir? It's too nice of a day to sit inside and read, Marcy. And besides, I have to build this snowman. If I don't do it, nobody else will. I'm his creator. It is my duty to give him life. This snowman has the right to live, Marcy.
You're weird, sir.
So, another predicament by. It was the day before the assignment was due, and Peppermint Patty still hadn't started her report.
Marcy, what book were we supposed to read for the book report again?
You didn't start the book report yet? And you forgot what book you're reading?
Oh yeah, forgot what to pick. Do you remember what I was reading?
Oh, you're hopeless, sir.
Don't abandon me in my time of need, Marcy. I've got to get this report done.
Just read The Grinch. If you want, I can lend it to you tonight so you can finish the report. That would be amazing. You're a lifesaver, Marcy. I just would hate to see you get another bad grade, sir.
And just in the nick of time, Peppermint Patty completed her report. She was so excited, she was the first to raise her hand to present her book report when they got to school.
Yes, ma'am. I'd like to go first.
Then, after class, she went to return the Grinch book back to Marcy.
Thanks for lending me your book, Marcy. What'd you think of my report? Pretty great, huh? I bet I got a better grade than you.
Did you even understand anything about the book, sir?
Of course I did. I figured all I'd need to know would be on the last page. Then I could figure out the rest of the story from there. I mean, how hard could it be, Marcy? It's a kid's book after all. You know, I really like that Grinch character. He seemed to be a pretty good guy.
Oh, you're hopeless, sir.
Thank you.
feeling a little down about his Christmas spirit. Before the play was to begin, he wanted to see if there was anything else that would cheer him up.
At long last, he had received a Christmas card. It was from Peggy G, a girl at summer camp. She and Charlie Brown had become good friends and wrote to each other on occasion since she lived on the other side of town.
After a kind gesture, he wanted to return the favor and find a nice Christmas present for her.
However, everyone else in the town seemed to be out and about shopping on that same day. Charlie Brown would have to wait in a long line to talk to any of the sales clerks.
I suppose we're going to have to listen to that bell ringer every time we walk by here now.
You're right. Everywhere we go, I still hear it.
Wouldn't you think you could do something besides ring a bell? How adorable.
Oh, just ignore that Santa Claus violence. There's nothing he can do to us.
Ah! Hey, I don't think you're a real Santa Claus. What do you have to say about that? Get out of here!
I don't think you're the real Santa Claus.
Yeah, what kind of Santa are you?
If you're the real Santa Claus, where are your helpers?
That's the dumbest thing I've ever seen.
Hey, I'm working hard here.
It's okay, Woodstock. You just don't understand Christmas.
After what felt like hours of waiting, Charlie Brown finally made it up to the sales counter.
Yes, ma'am. I'd like to buy a present for a girl I know. I was thinking maybe a pair of gloves. Would it help if I described her? Well, she has 10 fingers. Yes, ma'am. That would be great. What, $50 for a pair of gloves? Oh, ma'am, I think that's more than I can afford. Can I buy just a thumb? No, thanks. That's okay, ma'am. Rats!
Needless to say, Charlie Brown was pretty disappointed. After this encounter, he ran into Sally, Linus, Lucy, and her friends who also happened to be out Christmas shopping.
What's the matter, Charlie Brown?
I wanted to buy a pair of gloves for my friend Peggy Jean, but they cost $50.
That much, huh?
Well, she's gonna be disappointed to find out her boyfriend's a cheapskate.
I'm not a cheapskate. I just don't have $50.
Only $50?
I'm leaving. These shops are a little cheap for my taste.
I'm coming with you.
Me too. All these people keep bumping into my naturally curly hair.
Agreed. See you guys later.
After the others left, Charlie Brown was still brainstorming ideas on how to buy those gloves.
Just put on your credit card.
I don't have a credit card. I'm only 8 years old.
Well, so long, Peggy Jean.
Charlie Brown, don't listen to her. If she really likes you, she'll appreciate anything you get her.
No, no. If you don't give her exactly what she's expecting, she'll hate you for the rest of your life.
You know why I wanted to buy Peggy Jean those gloves? It's because she plays clarinet in her school's marching band, and I just don't want to see her hands get cold.
Give her a car to tell her to keep her hands in her pockets.
Well, let's see those bows.
See?
Well, they are pretty nice. Where do you think you're gonna get those $50?
That's the problem. I don't know.
I told you you should have sold Christmas wreaths with me.
Maybe you could sell your dog. I take it back. He's probably worth 25 cents.
Hey, that's my friend you called.
But stop, don't start something. They just don't understand us, remember?
It's gotta be something I can sell.
And so Charlie Brown had an idea. He went through all of his stuff in his room and came across his comic book collection.
Are you sure you wanna go through with this?
I'm sure. Plus, I think I'm finally starting to get into that Christmas spirit Lucy was talking about. This and the play just might do the trick.
Then, Charlie Brown returned back to the department store after selling his entire comic book collection.
Yes, ma'am, I sold it all. Now I can finally buy those gloves for Peggy Jean. What? They're sold out.
Charlie Brown was about ready to give up this whole Christmas spirit thing until he heard a familiar voice.
Brownie Charles?
Peggy Jean.
I thought I might run into you around here. Did you have my card?
Yes, I did. Thank you. What are you doing on this side of town? I was hoping to do some Christmas shopping.
My mom and I are out here shopping. She just bought me this adorable pair of gloves.
Then Charlie Brown's disappointment turned into relief.
I'm glad you got them. Truth be told, I was looking at those gloves you have on now. I wanted to find a way to repay you for that nice card.
Well, aren't you sweet, and you have good taste. If you're not doing anything later, I'd love to catch up after we're both done our shopping.
Really? You mean it?
Of course.
So Charlie Brown didn't need to sell his comic book collection after all.
However, catching up with a friend did help his holiday blues quite a lot. All he had left now was the Christmas play. Maybe Charlie Brown's Christmas wouldn't be so bad after all.
Small part in the show.
Guess what, Charlie Brown? I've been asked to be in the Christmas play. I'm going to be an angel.
Congrats, Sally. What do you have to do?
Here's my script. I have one line. When the sheep are done dancing, I come out and say the word hark. Then Harold Angel starts to sing.
Harold Angel?
It's right here in my script.
Charlie Brown was pretty confused, but Sally seemed to know what she was doing. Besides, hockey season was in full swing, and Charlie Brown was a big fan.
Go Flyers.
He had other things on his mind. Days had passed, and Sally was still practicing her line.
Hark! 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 How's my line that time, big brother?
Huh?
You're right. It still needs more practice. I live in mortal dread of going out there and forgetting what I'm supposed to say.
Even if you forgot what you're supposed to say, you could always make something up.
That's true. How about, hey?
I don't know. That doesn't sound very biblical, if you ask me.
You're right. I'll keep trying.
Sally did keep trying. She tried so much. She was starting to drive everyone around her crazy.
Shervy, Schroeder, you want to hear my line?
What line?
My line for the Christmas play, of course.
Well, let's hear it.
Hark!
That's it?
Yes, but be honest with me. Is it missing anything? Should I add any more pizzazz?
I don't think it's missing any pizzazz, Sally.
Yeah, I think it's as good as it's going to get.
Well, thanks for your feedback. I hope it comes to my play. Frida, Patty, Lydia, Eudora!
No, Sally, we already heard it. Go away.
Rats, I need another opinion.
We can help.
Hey, three, hey, four, you'd be willing to hear my line?
Why, of course.
I've been practicing. Hark! So, what'd you think?
That was perfect. No notes.
You really think so?
Really, really. What happens after that?
According to my script, Hare Angel comes out and sings.
Whatever you say, Sally.
Thanks for being such great listeners.
You're welcome. Have a great day, Sally. Don't forget your line.
Even though Sally was relieved that she had so many people hear her line, something about that conversation was unsettling to her.
After a moment, she had already forgotten. She was on her way to look for another listening ear.
Sure, Sally. I'll listen to your line.
Hark!
You got it.
Thanks. I'll see you at my play.
I've always wondered how all these actors remembered all their lines.
Days had passed, and it was finally the night of the show. Sally was all ready to go in her angel attire. Charlie Brown, Linus, and some of their friends went out to see her perform.
Looks like the play's gonna start soon. When did your sister come on?
She's on after the dancing sheep. She's supposed to come out and say, "Hark," then Harold Angel sings.
Harold Angel?
All I know is what she told me.
So Charlie Brown, Linus, and some of their friends enjoyed a good first half of the show. The dancing sheep had just finished performing. It was about to be Sally's turn.
Here comes your sister.
Hockey stick!
Hockey stick?
The second-hand embarrassment was too much for Charlie Brown and Linus to handle. They both got up and left the show. The next day, Sally could be seen venting to her brother.
Hello? Oh, hi, Becky Jean.
How was Sally's show?
Oh, where to start?
Oh no, did something bad happen?
Yeah, Sally messed up her line.
How'd she do that? She only had one.
I know, you'd think she would have known better.
So what happened after that?
I don't know. After she said hockey stick and everyone laughed, I left.
That's how she messed up her line? She said hockey stick?
I know, she messes everything up. She even thought somebody named Harold Angel was gonna come on after her.
Harold Angel?
I know. Excuse me, Peggy Jean. Someone's at the door.
Hi, is Sally home? My name's Harold Angel.
Thank you.
You won't have to use a dirty chimney flue. Just bring him through the front door, that's the easy thing to do. I can see me now on Christmas morning, creeping down the stairs. Oh, what joy, what surprise, when I open up my eyes and see a hip of Nero standing there. On a hippopotamus for Christmas. On a hippopotamus will do. From crocodiles or rhinoceroses, I only like hippopotamuses, and hippopotamuses like me too.
Much for man's best friend. Well, it's good to see you all here. As you know, we're gonna put on a Christmas play. Due to the shortage of time, we're going to get right down to business. One of the first things to ensure a good performance is strict attention to the director. I'll keep my directions simple. If I point to the right, it means focus attention stage right. If I make a slashy motion across my throat, it means cut the scene short. If I make a revolving motion with my hand, it means pick up the tempo. If I spread my hands apart, it means slow down. It's the spirit of the actors that counts, the interest that they show in their director. Am I right? I said, am I right? Stop the music. All right, we're going to do this play and we're going to do it right. Lucy, take those scripts and hand them out. Now, the script girl will be handing out your scripts.
Frida, you know the innkeeper's wife. Do innkeeper's wives have naturally curly hair? Pigpen, you're the innkeeper.
In spite of my outward appearance, I shall try to run and eat him. Thank you, Lucy.
Shermie. Sally, what are you doing here?
I thought I'd help out. After all, I didn't do too well my own Christmas.
Fine with me. We could use you as an extra if we need more angels or something.
Let me know if I can be helpful.
Snoopy, you need to be all the animals in our Christmas play. Can you be a sheep?
Bah.
How about a cow?
Moo.
How about a penguin? Yes, he's even a good penguin. Ow! No, no, no. Listen, all of you. You've got to take direction. You've got to have discipline. You've got to have respect for your director. Oh, I ought to slug you.
All right. Snoopy, go memorize your lines before the stop. Script girl, continue with the script.
Linus, you've got to get rid of that stupid blanket. And here, memorize these lines.
I can't memorize these lines. This is ridiculous.
Memorize it and be ready to recite when your cue comes.
I can't memorize these lines so quickly. Why should I be put through such agony? Give me one good reason why I should memorize these.
I'll give you 5 good reasons. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Those are some good reasons. Christmas is not only getting too commercialized, but it's getting too dangerous.
While you're at it, get rid of that stupid blanket. What's a Christmas shepherd gonna look like holding a stupid blanket like that?
Well, this Christmas shepherd's gonna keep his trusty blanket with him. See, you wanna hit an innocent shepherd, would you?
You're on thin ice with me, Linus. Okay, Mr. Director, the cast is set. Take over.
All right, places everybody. Action. Cut. No. Look, let's rehearse the scene at the end. Frida, this—
We can't go on. There's too much dust. It's taking the curl to my naturally curly hair.
It's nothing. It's just my natural aura.
Don't think of it as dust, Frida. Think of it as maybe the soil of some great past civilization.
Maybe the soil of ancient Babylon. It staggers the imagination. Maybe the soil is trod upon by Solomon, or even Nebuchadnezzar. It sort of makes me want to treat me with more respect, doesn't it, Frida?
You're an absolute mess. Just look at yourself.
On the contrary, I didn't think I looked this good today.
Fine, then we'll recast. Violet, come over here.
What do you want her for?
She's going to be the innkeeper's wife.
All right.
Anything to get me away from him.
Well, I'll put up with him if it means I can have more lines.
Lunch break.
Lunch break? We barely even got started.
Charlie Brown was beginning to realize he had bitten off more than he could chew with being the director, but he wanted to see it through, annoyances and all.
Giving everyone those scripts and being the Christmas queen has gotten me absolutely famished, Charlie Brown. I mean, just look at your dog.
Charlie Brown chose to ignore this.
Now look, we've got to get on with our play.
That's right. What about my part? What about the Christmas queen? Are you gonna let all this beauty go to waste? You do think I'm beautiful, don't you, Charlie Brown?
Charlie Brown did not know how to respond to this.
You didn't answer me right away. You had to think about it first, didn't you? If you really thought that I was beautiful, you would have spoken right up. I know when I've been insulted. I know when I've been insulted.
Good grief.
Clearly, his lack of response was the wrong way to go in this situation.
All right, let's take it from the top again. Places, everybody. Action. What is this?
This is a great play, isn't it, Chuck?
I'm having so much fun.
Charlie Brown was getting fed up. Nobody seemed to care about this play.
That does it. Schroeder, stop the music.
What's the matter, Charlie Brown?
Nobody seemed to be getting it at all. Charlie Brown was at his wit's end.
Don't you think this play is great?
It's all wrong. We haven't even rehearsed a single line.
Look, Charlie Brown, let's face it. We all know that Christmas is a big commercial racket. It's run by Big Eastern Syndicate, you know.
Well, this is one play that's not going to be commercial.
What do you want?
The proper mood.
But what could that be? Charlie asked around the room.
How about a Christmas tree? Would that help?
Yeah, a tree! A great big shiny aluminum Christmas tree!
That's it, Charlie Brown. You get the tree. I'll handle this crowd.
All right, and I'll take Linus with me. The rest of you, continue reciting your lines.
Get the biggest aluminum tree you can find, Charlie Brown.
Maybe paint it pink!
Yeah, do something right for a change, Charlie Brown.
Thank you.
for their play.
I don't know, Linus. I just don't know. I really hope this Christmas play makes it off the ground.
Yeah, hopefully they're practicing the lines while we're gone.
In the meantime, we better find a nice Christmas tree.
How about this place over here? Seems to be lots of trees to stop there.
As Charlie Brown and Linus entered the Christmas tree lot, they got a strange feeling about all of the Christmas trees. It was like they were all staring at them. Neither of them knew where to start. So Charlie Brown and Linus hunted through lines and lines of Christmas trees. Nothing seemed to be speaking to them except for one possibility.
Pick me.
They weren't super impressed. After a while, Charlie Brown came across one little tree sitting all by itself.
Gee, do they still make wooden Christmas trees?
This little green one here seems to need a home.
I don't know, Charlie Brown. Remember what Lucy said? It doesn't seem to fit the modern Christmas spirit.
I don't care. I'll take it and I'll decorate it. It'll be just perfect for our play.
Charlie Brown and Linus began venturing back to the auditorium to show the group their tree. Charlie Brown seemed really proud of his choice.
Meanwhile, the others at the auditorium were continuing to goof off. The only one that seemed to be paying attention was the play's musician, Schroeder.
This is the music I selected for the Christmas play.
What kind of Christmas music is that?
Beethoven Christmas music.
What does Beethoven do with Christmas? Everyone talks about how great Beethoven was. Beethoven wasn't so great.
Excuse me? What do you mean Beethoven wasn't so great?
He never got his picture on bubblegum cards, did he? Have you ever seen his picture on a bubblegum card?
Poor Schroeder was too stunned to speak.
I mean, how can you say someone is great who's never had his picture on bubblegum cards?
Good grief.
In an attempt to blow off some steam, Schroeder decided to play another one of his favorite songs.
Don't you have some lines you should be memorizing?
Let's get out of here.
While we're here, I made a list of Christmas gifts you might want to give me.
No thanks.
Wow, you didn't miss a beat. You know what? Never mind the gifts.
Phew.
Aren't you gonna ask why the change of heart?
I wasn't planning on it.
Well, I know it's because you hate me.
I never said I hated you.
Then you wouldn't mind giving an old friend one of those lovely Christmas presents, would you?
Good grief.
Schroeder understood all too well how Charlie Brown felt dealing with Lucy all the time. Unfortunately for him, however, Lucy had a little bit of a crush on him.
Hey, by the way, can you play Jingle Bells?
Yeah, I can play Jingle Bells.
No, I mean Jingle Bells. You know, deck them halls and all that stuff. No, you don't get it at all. I mean Jingle Bells. You know, Santa Claus and ho, 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 and mistletoe, and presents to pretty girls.
As you can see, Schroeder was still unamused by Lucy's antics. Clearly, he just wanted to practice the piano.
That's it! Now that I've heard everything I need to, I'll let you get back to your practicing. Charlie Brown should be back any minute.
We're back!
Perfect timing! Did you get us our perfect tree, Charlie Brown?
I did. I found this little green one sitting all by itself in the Christmas tree lot. I knew it would be just perfect for our play.
Boy, are you stupid, Charlie Brown!
What kind of tree is that?
I thought it was gonna be pink.
I knew he would goof it up. He's not the kind you can depend on to do anything right.
Charlie Brown, you were supposed to get a good tree. Can't you even tell a good tree from a poor tree?
You're hopeless, Charlie Brown. Completely hopeless.
You've been done before, Charlie Brown, but this time, you've really done it.
Yeah, take a look at this tree, everyone.
Sorry, Chuck. It's not a bad tree. It's just not the one they were looking for.
I guess you were right, Linus. I shouldn't have picked this little tree. Everything I do turns into a disaster. I guess I don't understand Christmas. Isn't there anyone who knows what Christmas is all about?
Sure, I can tell you what the meaning of Christmas is. Lights, please. And there, in the same country, shepherds abiding in the fields, watching over their flocks by night. And lo, an angel of the Lord came unto them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were afraid. And he said, fear not, for I bring great tidings of joy to all people. And unto you a baby is born in the city of David, a Savior. He shall be called Christ our Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. He shall be wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. He shall be called Emmanuel, God with us.
Bye.
think I'm gonna go for a walk. I'll see you soon.
Where is he going?
He just said he was going for a walk.
I see the wheels in his brain turning. Let's go with him.
Just perfect for our play. First prize. Well, I ain't gonna let this commercialized dog ruin my Christmas. I've killed it. Oh. Everything I touch gets ruined.
Little did he know, everyone from the auditorium was close behind, even the kids that made fun of him before.
I found Charlie Brown's little tree, but no Charlie Brown.
I never thought it was such a bad little tree.
It's not bad at all, really.
Maybe it just needed a little bit of love.
Here, let's take some ornaments off the display. We'll decorate it ourselves.
Charlie Brown is a blockhead, but he did get us a nice tree. You girls were way too hard on him. He just wanted us to have a nice Christmas party.
He did. Most of us were not too selfish to realize it, but we'll make it up to him.
As the kids were decorating the tree, Charlie Brown returned. He was shocked at what he found.
What is all this?
He saw a little tree that no one wanted, and he could hardly believe his eyes. His friend's efforts had transformed it into something truly special.
Surrounded by everyone, Charlie Brown realized that Linus had been right about the true meaning of Christmas. This is what he had been looking for all along. Nothing he could ever do would ruin this for him now.
At last, the season seemed 100 times brighter. And for Charlie Brown, it was truly the merriest Christmas ever.
Merry Christmas, Charlie Brown!
Thank you.
around, that you did a wonderful job. And I don't know about all of you, but I think they brought the spirit of Christmas to all of us. I'd like to thank Miss Hansel for all of her hard work. She has been working on this since last year. So she knew, and she had certain ideas for all of you, and I think you did a fabulous job in casting. I'd like to thank Mrs. Hoy for sharing your beautiful music with us. The backstage, stage crew, wonderful job. And to our teachers who also kept things flowing, as we saw all the places were perfect with the other children coming on. So thank you to the teachers who were working behind the scenes. And I do think that you really did remind us of the true meaning of Christmas. And that is sharing goodwill, helping those in need, and most importantly, creating a community where everyone feels valued and accepted. So thank you for that, and Merry Christmas, everyone.
Friends, just before we dismiss today, as you certainly know, myself, Father Kyle, Father Kelly, it's our first year here. And this has been an outstanding evening. You know, you need two things. You need talent and you need guts. And our kids have both of them. So thank you very much for the great job. We're very proud of you, and Merry Christmas, everyone.